After a long time we are doing a class, so without any delay let us just begin. Today I'm going to start with anatomy of leaf. Okay, so first of all you have learned a lot regarding the leaves in the morphology chapter. Now from anatomical point of view, how leaves would differ or what is the basic anatomy or structural internal structures present in the leaf, that's what we're going to discuss today. Now first of all you should know that on the basis of anatomy, leaves are of two types, okay, and they are the dorsiventral leaf and isobilateral leaf. Dorsiventral leaf are mostly found in the dicots, okay. They have distinct upper and lower surface, means the upper and lower surfaces are not going to be similar. How are they different? Now, mainly from morphological point of view, if I have to tell, then you have to we can define it in a manner that in dorsiventral leaf the upper or adaxial surface will be much more green, okay, and will have less number of stomata, whereas the lower or abaxial surface will be lesser green in color and also will have lesser number of stomata. Okay, so upper and lower surfaces being different or being distinct is the feature of dorsiventral leaf, which is mostly found in the dicots. All right, now moving to the isobilateral leaf. Isobilateral leaf is kind of exactly the opposite of what we have talked about in dorsiventral leaf. It is found in the monocots and it has similar upper and lower surfaces, means the upper or adaxial surface and lower or abaxial surface are both similar, means both of the surfaces will be equally green and will possess equal number of stomata. Okay, so in this class we are going to discuss in details both dorsiventral or dicot leaves anatomy and isobilateral or monocot leaves anatomy. Okay, so let us begin. So now let us discuss the anatomy of dicot and monocot leaf, or you can also say dorsiventral or isobilateral leaf. Okay, so let's start with dicot or dorsiventral leaf first. So first you can look at the diagram here. See, leaf being a flattened lateral appendage, it consists of upper and lower epidermis. The upper epidermis is also called adaxial epidermis and the lower epidermis is called abaxial epidermis. Okay, now in between upper and lower epidermis remains the mesophyll cells. If you remember, the ground tissue in the leaf is called mesophyll cells. These are specialized green color cells which are enriched with chloroplast, hence they can very efficiently perform photosynthesis, isn't it? So this entire thing that you can see in between the two epidermis, that is called the mesophyll cells, okay, leaving parenchymatous cells green in color due to being enriched with chloroplast. Now do remember, because it is a dicot or dorsiventral leaf, right, they have distinct upper and lower surface, right? So upper epidermis will have less number of stomata. This minute pore that you can see, or a gap that you can see in the epidermis, upper epidermis, that is a stomata. Okay, so upper epidermis in the dicot leaf have very less number of stomata in comparison to stomata present in the lower surface. Lower epidermis will have much more number of stomata. Sometimes in the upper epidermis stomata may be completely absent as well. Okay, another thing you should remember is that both upper and lower epidermis remains cuticularized, means it would remain covered up by a layer of cuticle, okay, or rather it will have a deposition of cutene. Cutene deposition would make it impermeable to water. Okay, this is a waxy coat that will be present in the upper epidermis also and lower epidermis also, and this waxy coat is called cuticle. Okay, it's made up of cutene. Understood? So what you have come to know right now, upper epidermis and lower epidermis are called adaxial and abaxial epidermis respectively. Upper surface or upper epidermis have lesser number of stomata in comparison to lower epidermis, and both the epidermises will be cuticularized, means they will be having a cutine deposition. Fine. Now, moving inside the upper and lower epidermis, this entire thing is the mesophyll, right? But then in dicot leaf, the mesophyll cells are of two distinct types. They are of two different types. Towards the upper epidermis, this elongated, compactly arranged cells that you can see, these are called palisade parenchyma. Whereas towards the lower epidermis, the circular or oval shaped cells that you can see with a lot of intercellular space, they are called spongy parenchyma. So palisade parenchyma and spongy parenchyma together makes up the mesophyll cells in dicot leaf. Understood? Now, both the types of leaf will efficiently perform photosynthesis. It's only the way that they are, arranged, how they are arranged, accordingly the difference is being seen. The palisade parenchyma is very compactly arranged, whereas the spongy parenchyma is having a lot of intercellular space. They are loosely packed. Understood? Fine. And the last thing is about the vascular bundles. The vascular bundles in the leaf would remain circularized or will remain surrounded by this red color marked you're seeing. These are thin walled cells called bundle sheet cells. Okay, always in the leaf, vascular bundles will be closed and conjoined. Cambium, of course, will be absent, and the vascular bundles will remain surrounded by bundle sheet cells with mostly the xylem towards upper epidermis and phloem towards lower epidermis. Is that clear? Understood? This is a overall idea regarding the anatomy of dicot leaf. From the diagram itself, you can understand very properly what it all means. So, diagram is very important. All right? So, let's read it out once again so that it becomes a revision for you. First, epidermis, it covers both upper and lower surfaces. Adaxial, under epidermis, we are going to discuss adaxial or upper epidermis and abaxial or lower epidermis. Okay? So first, adaxial epidermis, it is outermost layer of the leaf and it is single layered made up of parenchyma cells. It is cuticularized and chloroplast would be absent. Of course, chloroplast in the epidermis or the epidermal cells of the leaf will not possess chloroplast at all. But this is a very important information all of you should remember. In the whole epidermis, none of the cells might possess chloroplast. Fine, then none of the cells possess chloroplast. But you can see the stomata here, the stomatal pore, right? And you know very well, stomatal pore are always surrounded by a pair of GERD cells, isn't it? And those GERD cells will always possess chloroplast. So do remember, in the entire epidermis, none of the cells might possess chloroplast, but GERD cells, which surrounds the stomatal pore, they will always possess chloroplast. Otherwise, they cannot be controlling the opening and closing or, movement of the stomata. Alright, fine. Now, regarding abaxial or lower epidermis, it is lower epidermis that is exactly similar to the upper epidermis. That means it will be also made up of compactly arranged single-layered parenchyma cells. Okay. None of them will possess chloroplast except for the GERD cells. Okay, so it has more number of stomata in comparison to upper epidermis. Of course, I have told you in dicot leaf, the upper surface will have very less number of stomata. Sometimes stomata will be absent, whereas the lower, epidermis will possess many stomata. This is usually done why, because in dicot leaves, the leaves are going to be arranged in a straightened manner. Okay, so that sunlight will directly fall on the upper surface. If sunlight is directly falling on the upper surface and upper surface have many stomata, there is a risk that the plant might lose a lot of water. It might get dehydrated. To save them too much loss of water, most of the stomata are concentrated on the lower epidermis. Understood this? Fine. Now, regarding mesophyll. So, mesophyll cells are the thin-walled chloroplast-enriched parenchymatous cells found between upper and lower epidermis, and they can be of two types, palisade and spongy parenchyma. Palisade parenchyma, these are elongated, compactly arranged cells towards upper epidermis and usually maybe one or two layered. Okay, without any gap, they would remain arranged very, very compactly. Okay, and that's the reason why in case of a dicot leaf, the upper epidermis or the upper surface is dark green in color. I've already told you, right, that in a dorsiventral leaf, upper surface is more green than the lower surface. Why? Upper surface is more green because of compactly arranged palisade parenchyma cells. Alright. Now, next, spongy parenchyma. These are oval to rounded cells, loosely packed and remains towards the lower epidermis. So that's why, because of the loose packaging actually, there will be light green color present in the lower surface of dicot leaf. Okay, I hope it's being very clear to you now. Why the upper surface have less number of stomata than the lower surface and why the upper surface is more green in color than the lower surface. Both the reasons are clear. Fine. Now, regarding vascular system or vascular bundles, I've already told you the vascular bundles mostly will remain scattered in the spongy parenchyma and they would remain surrounded by thin wall bundle sheet cells, with xylem mostly towards upper and phloem towards lower epidermis. But there is a very important thing for you to understand here. See, all of you know by now from the morphology chapter that dicot leaves mostly possess reticulate venation, isn't it? Where veins and veinlets are all very different. Some veins are very prominent and thick, some veins are very thin. Likewise, there are different types of veins which together forms a network, hence reticulate venation, right? Now, the vascular bundles that are closed and conjoined and surrounded by bundle sheet cells, this, vascular bundles of the leaf, they mostly remain where? They would remain in the veins and the veinlets, okay? In the leaf, vascular bundles are mostly found in the veins and the veinlets. So, because in dicot leaf, the veins and veinlets have different types of thickness. Some are very thick, some are very thin, isn't it? So, here is the important information. All of you remember, in case of dicot leaf, the diameter or size of the vascular bundle will be directly proportional to the thickness of the vein. If the vein is very thick, then the vein will contain much larger vascular bundles. If the vein is thin, it will possess smaller vascular bundles. Okay, and as you know, in a dicot leaf, the most prominent vein is the midrib. So in that case, the midrib will possess the largest vascular bundles. Is that clear? Fine. So let's read it out once. Vascular bundles remain surrounded by bundle sheet cells. The size of the vascular bundle is directly proportional to the size of the veins. And the vascular bundles are conjoined and closed. Alright, so this is all about dorsiventral or dicot leaf. I hope it is clear to you. Let me give you a summary so that you remember it much more properly. First, the leaf possesses three components as per anatomy: epidermis, mesophyll and vascular bundles. Regarding epidermis, upper epidermis is adaxial, lower epidermis is apexial epidermis. Okay. In dicot leaf, upper epidermis have less stomata, lower epidermis have more stomata. Okay, and both the surfaces will be cuticularized to avoid loss of water. Okay, now coming to inside of the epidermis. Inside of the epidermis possesses mesophyll cells, which are of two types. Towards upper epidermis, we have compactly arranged elongated cells called palisade parenchyma, whereas towards lower epidermis, we have loosely packed oval or rounded cells called spongy parenchyma. Both the type of cells are enriched with chloroplast, hence can photosynthesize very well. Okay, clear? And at last, the vascular bundles. The vascular bundles, they are going to be surrounded by bundle sheet cells, with xylem mostly towards upper and phloem towards lower epidermis, and also do remember that because the dicot leaves have reticulate venations with thick and thin veins and veinlets running throughout, so the size of the vascular bundle will be directly proportional to the size of the veins.